Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'd like to start by reading a verse in the Bible. Revelation chapter 19, verse 16 and 17. It says, on his robe and his thigh, he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great, the mighty, and the awesome God. Hallelujah. As I was looking around, you see those things that are hanging over there. It says, Lord of Lords, King of Kings, and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. I just want you to remember this morning that you're standing in the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You might not be able to see him, but his presence is here. Hallelujah. The first song that we're going to sing is, വാഴ്ത്തുന്നു ഞാൻ അത്യുന്നതനെ വാനവും ഭൂമിയും ചമച്ചതും. Hallelujah. We're here to worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Creator of the heavens and the earth. And as such, we should completely and utterly surrender ourselves to Him who we worship. Hallelujah. Because He is more than worthy to be worshipped. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Vaazhthunnu njan athinnathine vaanavum bhoomiyum chamachathine vaazhthunnu njan athinnathine vaanavum bhoomiyum Jesus, Nada, be in me.
The King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter what's going on in our life. Just surrender it into His mighty hands and He will take care of it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
church worship team to then come and take over, and then we're going to be taking the offering also.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Let's continue in an attitude of worship. Our God is a great God, and we are serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You know, as we're going, as I just went through the book of Genesis and Exodus, and it talks about the life of Moses, and when he went up on the mountain for the Lord to speak to him face to face like a friend. When he was up on that mountain, the Lord told him, do not let anybody, do not let any single person, any single animal even touch the edge of the mountain, because I will send my fire and my power is so great that they will die if they even touch the end of the mountain that I'm on. But now, if we compare it to now and the grace and the freedom that he's given us now, it's so crazy that we can just enter into the presence of our God so freely. And we often take so much advantage, and we don't even like think about the power of the presence of God and how great he is. We don't have any fear of him nowadays, but as we're here in his presence, I know that he's here. I know that his Holy Spirit is so present in this place. And it says in the Word of God that one day we're all going to be meeting with him, and we're going to be in the new Jerusalem, that he will be dwelling among us, and we will be worshiping him day and night and night and day. So right now, as we're in the presence of the Lord, I just want you to praise him with your lips, praise him from the bottom of your heart. God, we praise you, we worship you for who you are, not just for what you've done for us, but who you are, God. I thank you so much for wanting relationship with us, God. When we are yet sinners, you died for us, and you choose to have relationship with us. You choose us, God, even before we even thought of you, you chose us, and you love us. You number the very hairs on our head. You know every single detail about us, and you want to encounter us, God. And we just want to thank you. We just want to praise you, God, for who you are, God, in our lives. And as we're here in his presence, I want you to just sing these words and just praise him. Praise him from the bottom of your heart. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And all the same.
Hallelujah. Lift up your hands to the Lord this morning. We are standing on a holy ground here. The Lord has come in our midst this morning. Whether you can see Him with your natural eyes or not, the Lord is here. He is looking at you. There are angels all around us as we worship the Lord. Just a replica of what is happening in the throne room of God. We are doing this in the earth below, and in His footstool we are worshiping the Lord. Lift up your hands and give Him the glory. I want you to give Him the praise to the Lord. Give Him honor and glory. Give Him the praise that is due unto His name. Can you bless Him this morning with your hands lifted up and say, Lord, You are worthy of it all. Whatever has happened in my life, whatever You have done in my life, whatever You have done in our church, Lord, You are the one who is worthy to receive honor and glory. Lord, dominion and power. Hallelujah. 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 Jesus, we bring You glory. We give You glory, Father. We lift You up high, Father, Lord. You deserve all the glory, Father, Lord. Heavenly Father, this morning, we come in Your presence, Father. We thank You that You, Lord, You have made us worthy to worship You. Lord, we were out there, away from the fold, but You drew us, Lord, with Your love and with Your compassion. You searched after us, Lord. You picked us up and You brought us, Lord, into Your sheepfold. You gave us everything that we need in our life, more than the material riches, Lord. You have given us the wonderful spiritual treasures that we can behold. This morning we can look to You, Lord, and we can worship You. I pray that You bless Your people. I pray that You use Your people, Father, in these coming days to be great instruments of glory and honor. I pray that You take us from Your lethargy and from the bondages that Satan has set upon us. In the name of Jesus, Lord, I break every bond of Satan. In the name of Jesus, Lord, God, who You are, Lord, that we can behold Your glory, we can lift You up, O Father. We thank You for this morning. Father, we bless You, Father, Lord. We pray that You bless the world as You're going to be partaking in our midst this morning. I pray for the tithe and offering that Your people have given to Your kingdom, to Your work. They have given out of what You have given them. Cheerfully, every penny that they gave, I pray that You do not, Lord, send them away empty. I pray that none of them lack anything in their lives. I pray that You bless the world this morning as we are seated in Your presence. Thank You, Father, for everything. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated in the presence of the Lord. We have a couple of ministries that we have to go through, so let me be getting right to the point. We have been going through a series called Broken Vessels. How God uses imperfect people. And we have been looking into how God uses broken and imperfect people like us. We are going to continue on the theme that God uses vessels of clay that are submitted for His purpose. When we submit ourselves to the purpose of God, God can take us and use us. Can you open your Bibles to the book of 2 Corinthians? We are going to read a few verses and I want to continue with the theme that the Lord has put in my heart. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And I want to read a couple of verses here. Verses 6 and 7. For it is God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure
in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. I want to talk to you about the power of God that is manifested in our life. In the earthen vessels, God has given a treasure that we are carrying around everywhere. It says that we are in a vessel of clay. We have this treasure that God has put in this vessel of clay. The word for treasure is thesaurus. Like the thesaurus that you have in your library, a thesaurus is basically a literary and verbal treasure trove of words. It's a treasure of words, literal words. You know, you cannot tell a book from the cover, so you cannot tell a person by the appearance. The most plain earthen vessels can contain the most priceless treasure of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I want to bring before your point is that we can never be 100% able to imitate Jesus, but we can contain and display the life of Jesus each and every day of our lives. As we read in this passage here, in verse number 6, Apostle Paul is comparing to the conversion of a sinner to the entrance of light at the dawn of creation, when God commanded light to shine out of darkness. We read in Genesis chapter 1 verse 3, and God said, let there be light. And God commanded light to shine through the darkness, and that was the beginning of the creation of the world that we know today. Just like the material creation of Genesis began with light, our spiritual creation is happening when the light of the gospel penetrates into us and we are born again. That is called rebirth or being born again. It's a common practice in those days to bury treasures in clay jars. And so just like the treasures are enclosed in earthen vessels, the Christ of glory is dwelling in our earthen vessels. Jesus is the light of the world. We know in John 8:12, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And he becomes the light inside us when we accept Jesus and receive him in our heart. When we receive Jesus in our heart, he dwells in us. So I want to ask a question to you. Have you received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord? If you have not done, I counsel you by the Word of God that you need to do that. It's not a show that you put on. You tell Lord Jesus, I invite you to come into my life. Be my Lord and be my Savior. Because it says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of life is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. If you die today in your sin, you are going to go to hell. I'm not going to mince words here. If you have not received Jesus in your heart as your Lord and Savior, if you die tomorrow today when you're going in the car back, you have a heart attack, you die at that moment, you're going to hell. Because unless Jesus has taken over your sins, you are ending up away from God, eternally separated from God. But when we accept in our human heart, Jesus comes and dwells in us. In the words of Colossians chapter 1 verse 27, Apostle Paul has said, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ comes and resides in our heart. And God offers that wonderful experience to anybody who believes in him. John 3:16 says, God loved the world. He gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Not only a belief that Jesus is there, but believe that he has come down, he has died for me on the cross, believe that He is my Savior, accept Him as my Christ and my Lord, and walk in the newness of life. And that is an experience that all of you should go through. It is a personal experience in your life. It is a experience that will change and transform you. So God shines in our heart and gives us a knowledge. The knowledge, I believe, is the gospel that God puts in our heart. The gospel that is free for all. It is available for all, but it is very costly, because to get this, Jesus had to pay the price of His own life. He had to give His life on the cross. We carry this in the earthen treasure in vessels. We carry this wonderful treasure. Today, what is the problem is that we become terminal of God's blessing. We receive the blessing, but we don't become a channel of His blessing. We don't reflect the blessing that God has put in my life. Many of us, we are so happy that we are on our way to heaven. We don't care about the fact that God does not just want to be terminals. God wants us to be channels and reflectors of His gospel. And so, as frail human beings, we are carrying a treasure that guides people to their eternal destiny. And this treasure is the glorious message of the gospel. And I want to tell you this, and this is through Jesus Christ. He helped to get us this wonderful message of the gospel. So, why has God planned this way? Why did He plan the treasures in earthen vessels? Apostle Paul answers this. If you look here, it says in verse number 7 that all praise and glory should go to God, the Creator, and not the creature or the humans. All praise, excellence of the power should be of God and not of us. This treasure can actually transform us and can empower us for His service. So this morning, I very quickly, I want to give you 3 secrets of how this treasure can empower us for the service of God. If you're taking notes, it will be a good idea to start writing at this point, because you can think about yourself and your bodies as an earthen vessel. How can this treasure really make you effective in His kingdom? Number one, the secret number one, and that is Apostle Paul is mentioning in the next few verses, and this is what it is. Depend on God daily. Depend on God daily. Let me read it out to you. From verses 8 to 12, I'm going to read you, follow with me in your Bibles. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus may be made manifest in our body. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, and the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. And then he says, so then death is working in us, but life in you. What is Apostle Paul saying here? He's saying that there is so much of pressure that comes in our life each and every day. If you think that life is easy, forget about it. Life is never easy. Every time we are under pressure. If you are in a workplace, you are under pressure to deliver the goods. If you are doing a study, you are under pressure with deadlines and projects and papers and presentations. You are always under pressure. And in the case of being a child of God, when we carry this treasure, we are always pressured to quit. It is very easy to give up. It is very easy to say, no, I cannot do it. You know what? That is very easy. Quitting is one of the easiest things. But Apostle Paul says, we should never be crushed. We should never be in despair. Even though we are hard-pressed, even though we are perplexed, don't be crushed. Do not be in despair. You know, this is the trials that a believer can face in his life. Remember, Apostle Paul, he did not have to go through this. He was in a very good situation. But when God called him, he had to go through a lot of problems in his life. He had to face ridicule. He had to face false prophets. He had difficulty in his finances. He had to face cold winters. He had to face imprisonment, mob violence, many, many troubles. The troubles of Apostle Paul are listed in another passage, which I don't want to go. His life was very hard. Don't think life is easy. Life is going to be hard, but what Paul says is, even though my physical body is growing weak, in all kinds of ways, in verse number 7 says, we can show the all-empassing, the great surpassing power that comes from God and not from us. And so, what it all simply shows is, we need to be dependent on God. Brothers and sisters, I want you to hear me. Even if you miss the whole sermon today, depend on God for everything in your life. Because He is the one who can make you complete. You know, following Christ is never easy. We may have persecutions in our life, but just depend on the power of God. Just like Apostle Paul. So we can stand when the pressure comes. When the hardships come in your life, we should not despair and give up. And with the assurance that God is never going to abandon us. How many of you agree with you? Agree with me. Praise God. Lift up your hands and say, praise the Lord. God will never abandon you. Your own people, your family may even abandon you. But God said, I will never leave you. That promise is always there. So verse number 10 says that we are carrying that death in our body so that the life of Jesus is revealed in our body. It's a little kind of a deep doctrine here, but I want to take your attention to Galatians chapter 2 verse 20. Where Apostle Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer that I live, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. You know, we are, the life that we live now, we are living to reflect Jesus. We are living to be a channel of His blessing, and that is what we need to understand. You know, this does not mean that we have to hurt ourselves, inflict some damage. No. What it means is that to our bodies, Christ should be revealed to other people. Because no persecution should ever stop us from believing and worshiping God. In the face of any trials, even if you lose everything in your life, just like Job is a good example. At the end of Job chapter 1, when he lost everything, it says Job did not complain. He fell down and worshipped God and he acknowledged, God, naked I came, naked I'm giving, you take away. He acknowledged that God is the one who gave and God can take away as well. And it says Job worshipped God. We need to worship God in the midst of any problem that happens in your life. Whether your body is weak, you are with sickness or whatever happens, you are in despair. Just trust in God, cling to Him, and He is the one who can do great things. Let me come to the secret number 2 of how this treasure can empower us for the service. The second secret I want to give you is from verses 13 to 15, is that we need to work in the same spirit of faith. The way the Lord instituted the church is, it's not a one-man show. It has never been a one-man show. It's a collective work of unity. God has given us different talents, placed us as different people in different situations with different backgrounds, with different things that we can input, but we all should work together. Let's read this, the verses from 30 onwards. Yeah, and it says, since we have the same spirit of faith according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke, we also believe and therefore speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us to you, with you. For all things are for your sakes, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving abound to the glory of God. In verse number 13, Apostle Paul is quoting from Psalms 116 verse number 10, where he says that the same spirit of faith, we believe and we speak. Many times if you hear yourself speaking, that gives an indication of what you believe. Some of the people, when they speak, they are very negative. All they say is, you cannot do this, you cannot go there, you cannot do that. Every time, because that is what they believe in their hearts. They cannot do it. When you believe like that, you speak it out. When you speak it out, it does not happen. You can never go to the place that God wants when you start speaking the words of negativity and doubt. One of the things I'm just telling all of you this morning is, whenever you open your mouth, speak something positive. Speak something that is good, that will raise people up for the glory of God. Don't speak things that will hurt people, that will pull them down. Many times we think, you know, we can criticize somebody and we can show a finger and say, hey, you do this, you do that, you are not good enough, you did not do right. More than that, let us speak positively, because if we speak what we believe, and more important than that is we work in the same spirit, because that is true in the body of Christ, because these are in the things that we believe. One of the secrets of a good ministry or a work of God is that all God's children work together in harmony. Harmony is a very big word. Even in a family, the husband and the wife, somebody may be a C personality, somebody may be an A personality, but when you join together, you work in harmony and you able to do the things that God wants. You don't clash with each other with every word. You work together. It's like working together in harmony. And that is what God wants, that we should be harmonious as we work to do the work of Christ. I'm reminded of like an orchestra. You know, everybody has a different instrument, but they all tune to one. The conductor is showing that's the one they play. They play in one accord. They bring out different sounds, but they all are harmony. If you decide I'm going to play my tune in my own way, it becomes a noise. It becomes a problem that nobody wants to hear you. But if it's in harmony, it brings about a beautiful music. And you can do great things for the glory of God. So today I want to tell you, as a church, when God has called you, we are all working as different members in harmony for the glory of God. Many of us have limitations. None of us are perfect. But we look over the weakness and we look at the plus things and we work together for the glory of God, because God should receive the glory. End of the day, whatever we do, He should receive the glory. Apostle Paul says in verse number 15 that all this is for your benefit. He says that it's all for your sake, for your benefit, so that it may cause much thanksgiving to flow for the glory of God. It is for the benefit of the body of Christ when we work together. You know, the word benefit is, it is helping people, helping the body of Christ, helping the kingdom of God. Working, you know, together in harmony will produce great benefits when we do it sacrificially as well. You know, it will make the Lord easy. If one man has to do everything, imagine, it won't happen. But when we take the Lord, we carry it together and just follow sometimes directions of people in leadership. If you do that, everything will be in harmony. Don't go in your way and say, hey, I know it better than anybody. In every instance, do it, because there is a leadership that God has placed you above, in your workplace. Listen to your supervisor. Do what he tells you. Don't go in your own way. In your family, listen to the leadership within the family. In a church, listen to the leadership. When we listen and do what the leadership under the vision of God tells, we can all work together in harmony. And that is the reason I think even in a family, God said it is not good for man to be alone. Because there was, should be, even in the case of a family, a man and a helper or a helpmeet together work in unity. It's a case of unity in oneness where they are joined together as man and wife and they do the things for the glory of God. And they bring out a generation that can glorify God as well. And so for us, let me tell you, we all need to work in one spirit. Finally, let me come to the third secret of how this treasure can empower us for service. It is, the third one is, we need to be renewed every day. Every day there should be a renewal. It is not one time. Many of us, I don't believe that you are lasting by your meal that you are eating on Sunday morning the whole week. I don't believe. I don't do that. I know none of you do that. You all eat every day. You know why? Because you need the strength for that day. Every day God wants to renew us. Each and every day. And so we look to the last three verses here of that chapter 16 to 18. Follow with me. Therefore we do not lose heart. Even though the outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed. The word is renewed. I want you to underline that. Is renewed day by day. Not Sunday per Sunday. It does not say that one day of a week. It says every day you get being renewed in your spirit. You get renewal. And then it says, for our light affliction, which is for a moment, is working in us a far exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things that are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporary, but the things that are not seen are eternal. The things that you can see with your mortal eyes, brothers and sisters, whether it is your big bungalow, big car, you know, big thing, whatever you see, they are temporary. They are not going to last forever. But the things that you do not see, those are the things that can last beyond eternity. So Apostle Paul is saying, where we should be putting our eyes on, you know, when we are wasting away with trials and persecution, the focus should not be on the things that we see, but on the things that we do not see. And Paul says, be renewed day by day, inwardly be renewed, because there is no point of quitting. This life is hard, it's a steep climb, but when you get renewed, you get the strength. Don't pray for, Lord, give me the bread for this week. Some people pray, Lord, give me the bread for the next week. No. Pray, and Jesus has taught us, give me this day our daily. Did he say weekly bread? No, he said daily bread. Every day pray that, Lord, you renew me today with your word. As I'm eating, that I'll be renewed. And so what happens when you're renewed like that? You know, we, our work is not in vain. And then Paul says, look at the way, look at the perspective of Paul. I want to draw your attention. Whatever troubles that you have today, they are light and momentary. It says they are light and momentary. And I want you to put that on a scale. On one side, the troubles, they are light and momentary. On the other side is an eternal glory that is going to be of much weight. So when we put the two together, Apostle Paul says that it is exceeding eternal weight of glory. It's much more weighty than the troubles that you go through. You need to see that perspective. When you see the things that are eternal and think about the glory that God is going to bring in your life, this trouble means nothing. This pleasures mean nothing. These things in this world that you enjoy means nothing. I am telling you, they mean nothing. Every day we are getting older. No matter whatever we do, we are all getting older. Every day we look at a birthday. You know, thank God for 1 year, but I'm 1 year older now. I cannot go back. We are going forward. Our bodies are decaying. You know, they say that the best skin of a child is that of a baby when he's born. That skin gets decayed and decayed as we grow up. Even though we are bigger, we are decaying outwardly. But it says, Paul says, even though outwardly I'm coming down, inwardly I should be renewed every day. So this is what I would want to tell you. What is it that you need to focus? The focus should be on eternal things. Don't look at your temporary. Don't look at things that you see around and put weight on that. If you have given a choice between the things of God and things of you, don't choose your own pleasures over God, because one day you will look back and you will regret it and say, why did I waste my time in frivolous living? Why didn't I do the work of God? One day, let it not happen. That's why God is reminding you that we need to remember, that we need to do and learn for God's kingdom. You know, Hebrews chapter 12 gives us a roll call of people of faith. You know why we even remember them after so many years? Because they learned to focus on God and His kingdom. You know, when we focus on Him, everything will be for eternity. So there is no ordinary Christian. There is no extraordinary Christian. There is a Christian, there's a child of God that God can empower, and it's all by His grace. That glory that is through Jesus Christ. Jesus lived and died for us, and He gave us the Holy Spirit who ascended from heaven and who came upon us. And today, through the Holy Spirit, He has transformed our jars of clay and transformed us for His service. So as I'm closing here, let me tell you, you know, Romans 13:12 says that night is nearly over. The day is almost here. Let us put away the deeds of darkness. If you have some habit in your life that is God is not pleased. Put it away and get yourself, put on the armor of light. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And then it says that when we are armed with the armor of light, there's a call that goes on in the prophecy of Isaiah. Chapter 60 verse 1. Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen upon you. When we put on the armor of light, the glory of the Lord will rise upon us and we can stand and do the work of God. Can we just close our eyes for a moment as we surrender our hearts this morning? You know, we are the children of light. We are not the children of darkness. We cannot behave like them. The light of the Lord is in us today in these jars of clay. We need to let go of ourselves and let God take charge. Hallelujah. We need to God the glory. Every eye is closed. Hallelujah. I want us to, as we are entering into the Lord's table, I want us to just sing a small chorus where it says, Lord, you deserve the glory. I want us, it's okay that you don't have to stand up right now. As you're seated, I want you to close your eyes and as we sing this a small chorus, we are acknowledging, Lord, you deserve the glory. Can we acknowledge and give the glory to God? Hallelujah. Let's all lift up our hands at this moment, everyone all across, and let's sing and worship the Lord. You deserve the glory. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
You deserve the glory.
Draw